Bonjour Roland Marshall.
Roland Marshall, hello.
Nous sommes dans un studio de
We're
Radio
here
France.
At Radio France, at la Maison de la Radio, with Christophe Boisbouvier from RFI Radio. Hello.
Bonjour Roland Marshall.
Hello and hello Roland Marshall. Pleased to see you again.
Roland Marshall, vous êtes.
Roland Marshall, you're an academic researcher with Série Sciences Po, specialized in Africa. We've often heard your analysis here or on other channels with Radio France and France Culture, France Info. In June last year, you were arrested in Iran as you were going to visit Fariba al-Anaba, your partner. She's a specialist of Iran. You were released on the 20th of March. She's still in prison at Elvin Prison in Tehran. You were accused of crimes against the state, propaganda, etc. But what happened on the 5th of June 2019 as you landed in Tehran?
Well, everything happened very fast. I had just arrived in Tehran, and I was going through the formalities to get the visa at the airport, as is the case nowadays, and it has been that for some years. And it was during that procedure where I was arrested by the Pastoran.
When and how did you learn that Fariba Adelka had also been arrested?
Well, I actually heard her voice about 3 weeks after I arrived at the prison, towards the end of June. So between my cell and the room where I was being interrogated, it was on that path that I heard someone call out Azadi, which in Farsi means freedom. Actually, during my time in prison, I came to understand the true meaning of a number of words. And it was her voice that I heard. The thing was, her cell was just a floor above, and the conditions in incarceration for women are very much different to those for men. The conditions aren't as strict. So she was actually able to see me, she recognized me, and she shouted out, and I very clearly recognized her voice. And it was then that I realized that she too was a prisoner. I saw her again on the 25th of September, 25th of October, and 3rd of February. And each time we saw each other, it was just for a few short minutes. We were able to speak sometimes, but sometimes not.
I understand, Roland, that you were in the wing for the Guardians of the Revolution, or rather for the prisoners of the Guardians of the Revolution.
Well, it's a bit different. It's not exactly a prison. It's not part of the Interior Ministry. It's more a prison run only by the Pasdaran. And I was in a high-security wing. I was very much in isolation. In fact, that was probably the thing most harrowing.
You didn't see the light of day, could you?
No, I couldn't. You really had to stand on your tiptoes to just get a glimpse of daylight. For me, I found it very hard. Naturally, I'm a workaholic. I have worked a lot on Africa, and I love it because of the light and the freedom you have there. So it really was very harrowing for me. For the first few days or weeks, I was just trying to get a notion of time. I tried to understand, you know, when breakfast would be served, when people would come with medication, or when you're allowed to sleep of an evening, just to get an understanding of when the 3 meals of a day would come. Time there was very monotonous, and it was very challenging to live through. As I said, I'm a workaholic, so it was very hard for me. I had no news from the outside. I had no idea why I had been detained, what the accusations were, how long I was going to be there. It was extremely trying. I would say, well, in isolation, you lose your memory. You forget so much. They were asking me questions which may have been very normal questions to ask because they were very much in link with current affairs, but I couldn't answer them. And then once I was released, I had access to TV. I started watching foreign films. I didn't watch them for the content because they were all dubbed in person. But I was just trying to understand and remember who the actors' names were, to rebuild my memory. And then, as time went on, I would spend days trying to remember the names of political figures that I had known so well in the past. So isolation, it's not just being cut off. It's forgetting everything you've done, everything you've written, everything you've worked on. And that is so very trying.
Les interrogatoires se passaient
plus. The interrogations were going worse and worse. The interrogators were becoming more angry with me. They would shout at me. So when you come from the quietness of your cell room and then you're put into a room where you have people shouting at you, shouting questions like, how is it possible that you can't remember all of this? From a psychological point of view, I'm sure they were using many techniques that are used by many other countries for interrogations.
Your first contact with the outside world was what, the French consul?
No, the first contact I had with the outside was, I guess, first and foremost, at the infirmary in the prison. Because I actually was able to see a doctor when I needed it in the prison. I had some serious ailments to deal with. I suffered panic attacks and claustrophobia, and it became very clear very soon that I needed to see a doctor. So first off, I saw a doctor in the infirmary, and it was such a pivotal moment for me. So I was given pills. I was drugged with 6 pills every night just to help me sleep, to deal with my stress, my heart palpitations, and many other things. But more than that, I was able to see time. It was a breakthrough for me because I could get back this notion of time, to understand what time of day it was, to know when prayers would happen, because every time I would hear the call to prayer, I was able to keep track of time. And that was so important for me. And then the consular visit took place on the 4th of July. And that was an important time for me because I was able to let my family know where I was. I hadn't had any contact with them. In fact, it was only on the 29th of August that I was able to contact my mother by phone for the very first time.
Et d'une certaine façon, bon, à ce moment-là, j'ai commencé à pouvoir demander.
And then I was also able to then start putting in requests. I asked for books to be sent to me, and I had friends, colleagues who sent me books. And really, it's thanks to that that I'm here today. And I think without them and the books, I don't know where I would be. I would certainly not be myself.
For months, it wasn't widely known that you were had been arrested. Fedelara Delra was announced in July. For you, it was only announced in October. I suppose that changes things when the media speaks about it. And I expect the French authorities were then able to speak in public. Did you feel that?
No, really, it was in February when, during one of my interrogations, someone took me aside and had a long conversation with me. Because I was surprised that I had been refused such simple things as being able to call my family. Those most simple things weren't even being given to me. So for that, I went on a small hunger strike, which is nothing like a ferry bar. And the interrogator said, look, this isn't really about you. This is all about negotiations for an Iranian who is in France. And he told me, your time here is just to put pressure on France. And I realized that I was just a bargaining chip. And in that, it was actually quite comforting, because it meant that there would be an end, and that end would be an exchange. And also it meant that my freedom wasn't tied up to legal proceedings.
What do you think is best, being discreet or a media campaign?
I think the media coverage did play a role, because one of my interrogators said that the international media thought I was dying. That wasn't the case, even though I was living through some very trying times.
I tend
to think that it was better off having the public aware of the situation because it raised concern. By the end, I wasn't treated any better than the others, but I wasn't mistreated nor abused in prison. I was still allowed to see a doctor and get medical care.
on n'est pas revenu sur les conditions de détention. On m'a pas
transféré dans une cellule. Sent to another cell.
Pour moi, aurait été la fin.
Because had that happened, it would have been the end of it for me.
Do you have any recent news of Fariba? She had kidney issues, didn't she?
Qui a été très longue.
Fariba went on a very long hunger strike.
Je demandais des réponses à des questions.
For me, I was asking very simple requests. I was wondering why I couldn't call my family, lawyer, the consulate, why I was no longer able to receive books. But Fariba had some very clear demands. She had seen me, and when we saw each other, I wasn't really tip-top, and she was very concerned by it. That is why she went on a very long hunger strike. Hunger strike is a very challenging thing. I have my own small experience in it, but you need to have very limited demands, or you need to know that it's going to be your last resort. And I think she had very ambitious demands. But the problem was the people on the other side, they didn't really care much for such behavior, and they just dragged it out. And that's why she suffered so much, and as you said, her kidneys severely suffered.
For the first time since you've been released, you agreed to speak up here today. Is this important? What is the message you're sending?
I think it's important because I lived through it. And I was able to experience it. It's very hard. It's harrowing to many aspects. But I think I need to talk about it. And I want people to know why it is so important to continue to mobilize to support people like Fariba and other research people who are held prisoners in Iran and in other countries in the area.
Thank you very much for giving this interview to our four media, France Info, France Culture, RFI, France Inter. Thank you.
Thank you very much.